Welcome to The Classical Mind, a podcast about the great books in the Western canon. We're your hosts. I'm Father Wesley Walker.
I'm Dr. Junius Johnson.
Junius, how are you? What have you been up to? What have you been reading besides Dr. Faustus?
I am good. I've been doing a lot of work on various things, reading some fairy stuff, getting ready for my fairies courses this summer, and also a science fiction series by one of my favorite authors, Timothy Zahn. And also just deep in Narnia, because I'm not only teaching about Narnia now, but I'm also writing a series of blog posts for Lent. I'm going through a different book of the Chronicles of Narnia each week for Lent. And that's been just really delightful lens through which to view the series. So quite a few things.
Now, when you say Timothy Zahn, you mean like of the Star Wars Expanded Universe, Timothy Zahn?
I do, yeah. His own original intellectual properties are really, really good. This one I'm reading now is probably my least favorite of all of them, actually. But I've read just about everything he's written, and he's solid all the time, and does a really great job with those in great plot twists and really builds our characters and worlds well. So yeah, definitely a big fan of his. I also liked his original Thrawn series.
I do too.
That's how I got into him. But yeah, his other stuff is quite good.
Excellent. Well, and I love your Narnia stuff. We just finished The Magician's Nephew with our oldest, and we're starting Chronicles of Narnia. So yeah, it's been fun to explore, starting Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. It's been a lot of fun getting into that with him, for sure.
Nice.
So today we are here to talk about Dr. Faustus by Christopher Marlowe, another English play, our second in a row after we did Julius Caesar with Heidi White last month, which was very, very fun. So to start off, I think it's always helpful. When did you first encounter the text?
I have these visual images in my head of reading this text that are a little bit confusing, because it seems to be my junior year high school English classroom, but I'm very confident that I did not read it then. I think I actually read it in college, probably my middle year of college, around the time that I was reading through Shakespeare. I certainly had a lot of memories of other memories of thinking about it and being aware of it while in my college dorm room, and I think I went straight on from Marlowe's Faustus to Goethe's Faust, and so which is an entirely different work that they really shouldn't even be considered the same sort of thing. That was a period I was an English lit major in college, and that was a period when I was just sucking up, you know, I was just going through literature as fast as possible, trying to get familiar with all these things that I kept seeing referenced and didn't know anything about. So that was part of my catch up period there. How about you?
Did you have a focus of your English lit, or was it just?
It was. I mean, you know, they make you do fairly broad stuff, but you get to specialize a bit at the end as you come into your thesis. And so I found myself focusing more and more on medieval lit the further along I got.
Makes sense. Well, this is my first time reading Dr. Faustus. It's one of those stories I've certainly has been in my mind. I am familiar with it, and I don't even know where or when it would have first kind of come in, but I'm aware of it, and I'm aware of terms like Faustian bargain and things like that. So you know, the meaning of the story has always, I guess, been fairly clear to me, even though I hadn't read it before. But I did really, really enjoy it. I thought it was an excellent read. I wish I had read it much sooner. I loved it.
Yeah, we gotta get this thing. We gotta draw some attention to this text, because, yeah, I'd forgotten. Like I said, I don't think I've read it since college. And coming back to it this time, I was just like, "Whoa, this is so fun! This is so good! I've got to teach this. Why have I not been teaching this?"
Yeah, and I think there's a lot of good moral instruction in the text that is directly applicable to many people today, or many situations today. I mean, I think that it felt enduringly relevant as I read.
Yeah. And I hopefully we'll get to the end of that more as we get towards the end of the play. But yeah, I mean, I would even go on to say that, which I think you would agree with, that it's enduringly relevant to every one of us, because we're constantly faced with, on a micro scale, these Faustian bargains. And it's really easy to look at Faust and be like, "You idiot, why would you do that?" when we're doing the same thing in a bunch of small ways.
That's right. It's like reading the Old Testament, and you think, "Oh, Israel, how dumb could you be? You know, why wouldn't you just worship God?" And then it's like, "But I also don't do that."
That's right. That's right.
The way I should, anyways.
Well, and I'll put in a plug right here up front, so I don't forget to do it later. That you know, a great use of this text, if you get into reading it with us and you love it, a great place to use this text would be if you're trying to get your students to think and talk about Christian theology, but you want to do so from literature. Mm-hmm. This is actually a really good way to bring up some core conversations about theological doctrines, as I think you'll see what happened in our conversation here, that is much more accessible and for the student who's not read a lot of theology enjoyable than trying to read a properly theological text would be.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. In fact, we might want to talk a little bit about some of the context behind the play before we get into the play, because there are some really interesting things about the history and the textual transmission of the story that can impact our reading of it. And so we might want to start, I think, with the historical context in which Marlowe was writing. Marlowe was relatively contemporary with Elizabeth I, Queen Elizabeth I. And so, therefore, his cultural outlook would have been very much shaped by the English Reformation, which was a very tumultuous time in England. And as an Anglican priest, I feel uniquely qualified to talk about it. Just kidding. But historically, you know, before the Reformation, England was a basically Roman Catholic nation since about 500, for sure. And even before then, there was Catholic Christianity there. Mm-hmm. And so, of course, the English Reformation began with Henry VIII. Of course, many people say he wanted a divorce. He actually wanted his marriage annulled. His wife, Catherine of Aragon, had been married to his older brother. The punishment in Leviticus for marrying your brother's wife is childlessness, and that is what Catherine and Henry experienced. And so he began to really believe that his marriage was forbidden by the Old Testament, and so they went to the Pope to appeal for an annulment, and he was not granted it. Ironically, probably because Catherine's cousin had recently sort of taken the Pope as a political prisoner, and so he was much more friendly to Catherine's case than the case that Henry was making. And so what happens as the result of that rejection is actually the same debate that was happening in Dante's day, or a similar debate as what was happening in Dante's day, which is how does the papacy and the authority of the church connect to or interact with the authority of the state?
Mm.
And so the English Reformation became Henry VIII really taking the church in England out of communion with the Roman Catholic Church and establishing a state church, mm-hmm. in effect, in which Henry was the head of the church. In fact, that was a term often used for the monarch of England for some time, was head of the church.
But wasn't it even still said at the coronation this past year?
Is it? I thought maybe they had toned that down a little bit. Maybe, but you might be right. I don't remember.
We'll go back and check on that.
Yes, we will. We will. So Henry himself theologically was a Catholic. So mm-hmm. under his reign, I mean, as far as the liturgy of the church and the theological convictions of the church, everything stayed very similar. But when he died, his throne passed to Edward VI, who was a very Protestant, or at least his advisors were very Protestant. He was a boy king, and so he didn't make a lot of his own decisions. But the church really changed under Edward. You weren't allowed to call it the Mass anymore. You weren't allowed to elevate the host and the chalice. You weren't allowed to wear the vestments that historically priests wore. The stone altars were all replaced with wooden tables. And so there was a pretty radical change there. And then Edward died as a young man, and Queen Mary took the throne, Bloody Mary, who was Roman Catholic. She was the daughter of the one surviving child of Henry and Catherine's marriage. And she brought the Church of England back into full communion with Rome. England was absolved of all ecclesial sins committed under Henry and Edward. Mass was restored, but then Mary and the papal legate who helped her do this, Reginald Pole, died within 24 hours of each other. And the throne passed to Elizabeth.
Purely natural causes, by the way.
Purely natural causes. That's right. That's right. It wasn't like a Protestant conspiracy or anything like that. So then Elizabeth comes to the throne. She's a Protestant, but of a more moderate variety. So she establishes the Elizabethan settlement, which makes the Church of England a decidedly Protestant body, but they were a little friendlier to Catholics. They stopped killing each other at the same rate that they had been And but you still get, because of all this back and forth, and because of the Catholic heritage of the Church of England, and because the English Reformation was generally more moderate than maybe the Lutheran or Calvinistic or Anabaptist reformations, you still get kind of a mixture of impulses, some Protestant impulses, some Catholic impulses, some Catholic tradition retained, some Protestant innovations incorporated. And so it got really messy, and it's an interesting time. Marlowe is living kind of when, as Catholicism is kind of becoming culturally deconstructed, and it becomes a little unclear what exactly the Church of England would be. And so throughout the text, you get a kind of mixture of impulses. There are some things in the story that strike me as very Catholic. There are some things in the story that strike me as pretty Protestant. And it also depends, of course, on which text it is that yeah. you're consulting. But I think that it helps to understand that. And Marlowe himself was educated in literature, but was taught to write poetry in Latin. Mm-hmm. So he's a part of a group of poets in his day who are trying to write English poetry, but they're not really sure how, because they only know the Latin conventions. So you get like the blank verse, which Marlowe is one of the first ones to really incorporate that, which is where the prose doesn't rhyme, but it's written in iambic pentameter. Mm-hmm. And so it's a very interesting situation in which Marlowe's writing. And I do think you see that in the work itself.
Yeah, I think that's right. And we'll highlight some of the places for the readers where you see some of those differences. But before we get into that and the matter of the play, would you also say a little bit about the two versions that we mm-hmm. have of the play and why we have two versions and yeah. what the differences between them are? And readers, you know, depending on what edition you have, it may not be clear which version is going on. I have this really old version, this really old copy I must have gotten from a used bookstore when I was in college, and it's falling apart in my hands as I read it. I'm going to have to tape it up after we're done here. But I had to do some digging to figure out whether I was reading the A text or the B text. And so if you could say a few words to help us kind of understand what's going on with all that stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. So Marlowe died in 1593. The first text that we have of the story was published in 1604, and it's called the A text. The A text tends to be more Protestant and Calvinistic leaning. Faustus seems predestined to be reprobate. You get that line, que sera, sera, what will be, will be. There's more of an emphasis as well in the portions where he's trying to be convinced by good characters to turn from his wickedness, that he really just needs salvation by faith alone. Which was, of course, a big Protestant talking point. The B text was published in 1616, so it's a second text, and it's either more Arminian, which is certainly possible, because at that point, by 1616, you do start to get closer to figures like William Laud in the Church of England, who was an Archbishop of Canterbury, King Charles I, who are both fairly outspoken Arminians, or it's Catholic. Or a little bit of both. I mean, it could be a mixture of things. So you have these kind of tensions in the two different versions of the text. And the question is, well, which one has priority? I mean, this almost felt like an exercise in biblical studies, which was what my major was in undergrad, you know, trying to figure out, well, which of these manuscripts is older and how do we determine, you know, which of the Gospels was written first, these kind of things. So in my version, which is edited and the introduction is written by David Wooten, he makes the point that there are kind of three ways that an English script might come down to us from this era. The first is that you might have the foul papers of the author, which is just kind of his notes and his handwritten version of the play. But the problem with those is that you get all sorts of notes intermingled and corrections and changes and striking and all these. It's a mess, right? So to hand that to a publisher at that time would have required the publisher to do a lot of work in terms of arranging the text the right way. So that's one option. The other option is that we could receive a more polished and complete prompt book. And a prompt book was often kept by the stage manager of a play during the Victorian the Elizabethan era and later. And it was more complete. It was pretty much finished. And it's what the actors would have used during rehearsals. And if they forgot their line during an actual performance, it was open and followed along by someone who could feed them the line from the prompt book. So it was sort of like the official version of the show. Mm-hmm. Whereas the author's foul papers is kind of unofficial. It's the things that get you to the prompt book.
Right.
The other final way that you could receive a play from this era would be a reconstruction from the memory of someone who was involved in the play. So you hire an actor who starred in the play, who knew most of it, or you hire the stage manager, or maybe a combination of figures who was connected, who would have been able to, from memory, reconstruct most of what had gone on in the play, and you have basically the same thing. So it's probable, at least Wooten concludes, and there have been many scholarly opinions about where the A text comes from, where the B text comes from, and which one is closer to Marlowe. The A text seems to have come probably from a reconstruction, based on the actors or someone involved. And Wooten likes this theory because there are some Greek and Latin texts or Latin in the text that is just kind of meaningless or misquoted. It's like what an uneducated actor would think the Greek word is, but it's not really a Greek word. And if you compare it then with the B text, you can see where the proper Greek is.
Mm.
Now, after Marlowe died, so that's the A text, reconstruction. After Marlowe died, two other playwrights were commissioned to kind of come in and clean up the manuscript. And that's probably where the B text comes from, was William Bourne or William Byrd. His last name is presented two different ways, and Samuel Rowley. So they would have heavily edited and supplemented. So there are stories or scenes in the B text and exchanges in the B text that are not in the A text. And so my translation uses the A text, but it makes a lot of notes because it's a Norton edition, and it makes a lot of notes about where A and B diverge. So like the old man who comes to convince Faustus towards the end, you know, he appears somewhat differently in the two texts.
Mm.
And so it'll make a note about, okay, in this text he does this, and in this text he does that.
Mm. That's all really good. It's so fascinating. And so, you know, that's something that how deep you want to get into that stuff as a reader depends on, you know, a little bit. It gets a little fetishistic after a while, but I think that there is, you know, what's interesting is whichever text you find yourself reading. If you find that you're reading a text that seems to be more Calvinistic about how much choice Faust actually has in this thing, or more Catholic or Arminian, depending on how you want to read it, about that level of choice, you can be, the awareness that the other text exists puts that conversation back into the larger theological conversation about just that question.
Yeah, right? Exactly.
And
exactly.
What's great about it is that Faust is, for all that Faust is supposed to be the greatest scholar of his day and an expert at all the things, his theology does get pretty loose as he goes through talking about these things. And so even it's kind of felicitous, actually, that you can't necessarily fix what Marlowe was saying Faustus would have thought theologically, because Faust's theological thoughts are not really that determinative anyway, right? You've got to listen. In some ways, Mephistopheles is a better theologian than Faust is, and you've got to kind of play them off each other. So it sets you up nicely for that sort of exchange. Well, as we transition into the content itself, one thing that stood out to me that I think I'm going to go ahead and flag right here at the beginning is that there are two sets of action running in parallel throughout this thing. There's what's going on with Faust and the demons above all Mephistopheles, and then the great men of the world that Faust is in communication with, the emperor and the duke and these sorts of things. And then there's what's happening with the commoners, starting with Faust's servant, who seems to have picked up some secondhand magic and goes out. And then you see this starting to spread a bit, and various characters of these commoners, who are this, you know, comic relief in the middle of this very otherwise very heavy tale, are experimenting with incantations and magic, and then, you know, accidentally summoning demons and being punished for it and whatnot. And then towards the end of the play, you get those two worlds start to come together when you see this Faust has been swindling commoners just for fun, right? Because it's not as if he needs the money or anything. He can always just have Mephistopheles dredge up a shipwreck and bring him gold. He's got a bunch of different ways to get money. He's just like, seems to enjoy messing with people and getting the better of them, and it amuses him. And we'll see that both with personages great and small. And so those two things just seem to collide, but it is an interesting dynamic that runs throughout the play, that what's happening at the higher levels of society that Faust is moving in is being imitated at the lower levels of society that are sort of moving in the wake of what Faustus is doing.
Well, and doesn't that sort of speak to Faust himself insofar as his, like, why trick the commoners? It's not out of need. It's out of a sort of sadistic cruelty. Mm. Well, yeah, he's hanging out with a devil all the time. So, like, of course he's going to start imitating that.
Bad company. That's right. And also because, you know, he himself is not a noble. I mean, he's a student and he has access to all these great figures because of the bargain that he made. Given the way he's described, it's likely that his learning would have brought him into contact with these great figures eventually, but that's not why he's there. And so there might be some sense of wanting to distance himself from the rabble by treating them differently. And of course, like, you know, like you say, he's acting like the devils, and the devils, they aren't just, it's not just that they are trying to damn your souls. That's job one. That's the most important thing. And Mephistopheles says, God, what wouldn't I do to get this guy's soul, right? But there's also, there is a just spitefulness about it, a petty spitefulness about the demons that we see being manifested in Faust's relations as well. Mm. Sorry, I was thinking about something. I don't remember what I was thinking about. Can we start with his catalog as he's running through all of the major disciplines of the day and deciding that none of those are going to work for him anymore?
Yes. Yes. I thought that part was very interesting.
Yeah, it's really great. So the first thing that he settles on, this is scene one, act one, scene one, just after the chorus goes out. Well, even before I say that, the last couple lines of the chorus here, in my version, I really like this. He surfeits upon cursed necromancy. Nothing so sweet as magic is to him, which he prefers before his chiefest bliss. That's a really good bit of chorus at the beginning to sort of set up the theme of the whole play. This choice between magic, which offers immediate delights and immediate sweetness, and then this other type of joy, which the chorus already calls his chiefest joy, right? It's not just a question of the magic is going to be short-lived and the other joys are eternal. It's also a question of he's got his priorities wrong, because whatever joy he can take from magic, there's a chiefer joy, a greater joy that he would feel in this other thing. So it's not merely a quantity issue. It's also a quality issue that Faust is ignorant of, or not ignorant of, is choosing to ignore here.
Yeah.
His non-ignorance is really central to the story. And that's why I think we have to begin with this passage of him in his study going through all of this stuff, asserting that it's not for lack of exposure that Faust makes the choice that he makes. He has all the information he needed to have made a better choice.
Yeah, for sure. It's not out of ignorance. I'm reminded Hugh of St. Victor has an interpretation of the wedding feast at Cana, where he says, you know, the Jesus turns the water into wine and the wedding manager comes out and says, wow, you saved the good wine for last. Mm. And he says, this is how the gospel works, because the world and the devil promises us the good up front, but once you give in to the vice, once you give in to the sin, then it becomes bitter later. Whereas the gospel, pick up your cross and follow me, this is the way you attain salvation. At the beginning, that's a very bitter drink, but it becomes sweet at the end. And so Jesus kind of foreshadows that in the wedding feast, and you see Faust explicitly rejecting it here.
That's so good. Am I remembering correctly that there, among the multiple instances of prophets eating scrolls in the scriptures, in one instance, the scroll is honey in the mouth but bitter in the stomach. And in another instance, it's the reverse.
That sounds right.
Yeah, we should look into that too.
Yes.
Listeners, we're looking at all kinds of stuff here after the fact. Maybe we'll drop you.
This is why you should be a supporter of the podcast, because I can put these follow-ups in the chat, but only for the paid subscribers.
There you go. So if you want to know the answer to these questions and you don't want to look them up yourselves, just pay us money. So we find Faust in his study, and he's trying to figure out, okay, let's figure out, I've gone through all these studies. Now I've got to pick a profession, right? I'm going to do this for the rest of my life. And so which one am I going to do? And he starts off and says, You know what? Let's do Aristotle, right? We'll do philosophy. Sweet analytics, 'tis thou hast ravished me. And so he pulls out his Aristotle and he reads, to dispute well is the chief end of logic. Well, is the end of logic anyway. And he was like, was that it? Like, I can do that already. So like, I've already conquered philosophy, so forget that. Read no more, he says. Thou hast attained that end. That's that's an echo of Paolo and Francesca in Inferno, where they're reading about Lancelot and Guinevere, and which is a bad love relationship, right? Like, you do not want your relationship to be like Lancelot's and Guinevere's. And they get to the point where the two of them kiss, and she says, we read no more. And they started doing instead of reading. Well, the next bits in the text are really, really important from the standpoint of understanding what it is you're choosing to do here, right? And so Faust also has this, he stops reading because he thinks he's past it. So then he goes on to Madison, right? And he says, let's look at Galen. And the goal of medicine, summum bonum medicina, is sanitas. The highest goal of medicine is health.
Mm-hmm.
And Faustus says, I've done that too, by which he means not just I am healthy. What he means is I've been giving up prescriptions to people and they hang them up in the street, and entire cities have been spared from the plague because of following the health regimens that I prescribed when I was just a graduate student. So no point in doing anything more with doctoring there. Now, again, he misses the point, right? The point of the complete doctor is not the one who has attained the capacity to heal any patient theoretically. It's the one who actually heals patients, right? Not a theoretical health, but a practical health.
Yep.
And so once again, he stops short of what the thing is really all about. So goodbye to that. He goes to the law next, Justinian. And he reads all these things, first of all, if the same thing belongs by right to one, then to two people, then blah, blah, blah. And again, you know, the father is not able to disinherit a son unless he does blah, blah, blah. And he says, this study fits a mercenary drudge who aims at nothing but external trash, too servile and illiberal for me. Now, that's a really cool line for us to stop and pause on, because this podcast, listeners, is called The Classical Mind. And in the classical tradition, we have this distinction of, you're familiar with the liberal arts, the arts that make men free. And so Faustus is saying here that the law is not a liberal art, not necessarily that it would bring you into bondage, but that it doesn't actually set you free. And then he calls it servile. The servile arts are opposed to the liberal arts. I've never liked that name, because it's bad for our age. And it was very clear in the Middle Ages that meant they're servant arts. But in our time, it makes it sound like they're slave arts, right? Yeah. And especially you oppose it to liberal, right? What's the opposite of a free man? It's a slave. There's more options than that, guys, but that's what we're used to on this side of the Enlightenment revolutionaries. So the older name for them besides servile was mechanical.
Mm-hmm.
And so these are the arts that serve the necessities of human life. You kind of can't get to the liberal arts in a sense unless you're involved in the mechanical arts, because that's where like food and clothing and shelter and all of those things come from, right? And so this is what Faust is on about is, again, right here at the very beginning, we see him wanting to separate himself from the common person who would work in those things. He refers to the objects of the law, which are to make sure every man has his due. He refers to those things as trash.
Yep. Yeah, it's interesting because trade was considered one of the servile arts. Which I find interesting, because I think once you get into the sort of mercantile revolution, I mean, it becomes pitched as this is a way of freedom, right?
Yeah.
Through economic gain, you become free.
Yeah.
But I think the liberal / classical tradition would kind of warn us about that.
Yeah.
And here you do see Faust as kind of, I mean, I do think it's interesting that he highlights that it is too servile. I mean, yes, a servile art, it is a liberal. You do have a kind of, in all these areas, he seems to bristle at the point where the study actually comes into relationship with application.
Yes.
That involves other people.
Yeah. And we see him with all of this power that he attains. He spends very little time with other people except to demonstrate his power, right? Towards the very end, we see him having some fellowship with scholars, but even then, you know, they're sort of, it's because they're adoring students fawning at his feet. He claims that what he wants is to study the liberal arts because he wants to be free. And this is what the classical tradition is warning about and calling trade a mechanical art, is that it may offer a more scope for action, but that's not what true freedom is. Right. And so this is where we get confused, because once we started to think that freedom means the power to do whatever you want, or at least to make your choices unimpeded by anything other than simply your will, then trade and economics do look quite liberal, because they are liberating in that sense. But the older understandings of freedom, of which there were several, none of them were that understanding. They had to do with things like freedom is about being capable of doing the right. It's a freedom to do things rather than a freedom from things. And so Anselm would say you're not free if you're not able to be just. If you can't choose to do the right thing, then you're not actually free, no matter how many choices you have in front of you.
And this is the distinction, right, between liberal and servile arts. Is the servile arts are there out of necessity. You have to have food, you have to have clothes, you have to have these things to survive. So they are necessary, and that's why they're not inferior insofar as they are arts. Are required. Yeah, they're arts. But the liberal arts are more about that side of us that we call human. You know, it's not just about the eating and drinking. It's about the way to think and the way to live and flourish as we live.
That's what separates us from beasts. That's right.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So that's where the distinction comes in. Of course, the irony of this is that Faustus wants the liberal arts, the freedom, and he willingly places himself in bondage.
Yes, yes. And one more word about the servile arts before we leave them, which I know you'll appreciate being a Hugonian. The performing arts, what we call the fine arts today, were placed under the servile arts back then. Drama, you know, theater, music, all that kind of stuff. That's, well, music is different, is weird, because you've got music as a liberal art, which really is the theory of music, and then you've got music as performance, which is what we call the fine art of music, which is actually a servile art. Why? Because the servile arts do two things. They provide us with the things that we need, and they provide us with things that delight us. And so it's important to keep in mind that, you know, another argument against them being servile in the sense of slavish is that everything delightful is provided for us, you know, delightful in the sense of the lower parts of us, not the intellectual delights, is also provided for us by those arts.
Yeah.
So yeah, Faust claims he wants to be studying the liberal arts because presumably he wants to be free, and yet he puts himself under a contract. He seems to think that he's getting the better end of this contract at the beginning, but that's a kind of willful ignorance. But then on the other hand, you know, once he has the power, what does he spend it on?
Right.
He spends it primarily on things that would belong to the servile arts. He does spend 8 days inspecting the heavens to their furthest reach in a chariot drawn by dragons, so that he can understand the different orbits of the stars and the planets and things like that. But that's 8 days out of 24 years. As far as we can tell from the text, the rest of the 24 years seem to have been spent almost entirely in pleasures of various sorts.
Yeah. We should probably say one word too before we leave this portion about his rejection of theology, which is, you know, this is kind of the great irony. In fact, at one point he's likened to Icarus, you know, flying too high. And I think you really see that in his rejection of theology. He thinks he's very smart, but his rejection is, he quotes First St. John. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and there's no truth in us. So why then belike, he says, we must sin and so consequently die. We must die in everlasting death. What doctrine you call this? Que sera, sera. What will be, shall be. Divinity adieu.
Yeah.
Which is not a very robust theological reasoning, especially you're quoting from First St. John, which is all about God's love and the incarnation as a means of salvation. And but you proof text that one verse and therefore dispose of the whole field of divinity. It was very interesting.
Yeah, that's right.
I, out of all his rejections, it's probably the worst one.
100%. And even before, you know, the other one he quoted was in Romans, Dipendium peccati mors est, the wages of sin is death. It's funny. I can remember memorizing that in Latin back before I knew Latin. When I was reading this, I was like, oh, I love the way that sounds. I'm going to memorize that. The whole point of Romans, right, is who shall save me from this body of death? Right. Thanks be to God through our Lord Jesus Christ. He doesn't get that far. He stops at Dipendium peccati mors est. You know, well, if we have to die, then I might as well rush into it headlong.
Yeah.
Okay, this is a great point to draw the contemporary parallel, because there's a lot of people I've known in my life who kind of feel like, well, if I'm gonna go to hell anyway, might as well enjoy myself on the way, right?
Yep.
That's got to be the way it is. So what is all of these rejections have in common? That they are very shallow reads of the authoritative texts for the discipline. Now, that's surprising for someone who's first introduced to us as a scholar unmatched in disputation. I would submit to you, because typically what it means to, you know, in the medieval schools to which he's still heir, you know, Wittenberg has still got a lot of the medieval scholasticism about it at this time. It's all about reading closely, making fine distinctions and subtleties and this sort of a thing. And he has none of that. Mm-hmm. And yet we're told in a later scene that the students refer to him as someone who always made their halls ring with his sic probo. Thus I prove it. He never lost a fight. It seemed like an undefeated heavyweight philosopher of the world. Abelard had that same distinction in the Middle Ages. Didn't do him much good either.
No.
I would submit that Faust is being portrayed here as a sophist.
Yes, I was going to make the same point.
Right? Yep. It's about, he's a great rhetorician. He knows how to win battles, but he doesn't, not only is he not right all the time or hardly ever, but he doesn't understand the meanings of the things he's arguing about.
This reminds me of, I was on the debate team as an undergrad at Liberty University, which we had a great debate program, still do. And, you know, debate is really helpful. I'm very thankful that I was on the team, but I, for a couple of years, had to really unlearn some bad habits. Like a conversation or a dialogue is not about winning.
Yeah.
But for so long it was, you know, because I mean, that's how you're rewarded. You win the debate, you win the tournament. You know, but then it's not really about truth. It's about winning.
Yeah.
And,
that's right. Rhetoric is the art of persuasion.
That's right. That's right. So it's of course important to be able to be persuasive, but towards that being persuasive has to serve the greater end of truth.
Yeah.
And of course, what we've seen with Faustus here so far is a willingness to jettison the greater end for lesser ones.
Yeah. So Augustine says in book four of De Doctrina Christiana that if falsehood is going to make use of rhetoric in the fight against truth, why should truth enter the battle unarmed?
Right.
And he's very cool because he says rhetoric is a helpful tool for just this reason, but it's not a necessary tool. If you already know it, then you should use it. If you don't already know it and you're past a certain age, don't bother trying to go learn it. Just spend that time in the scriptures instead.
Yep.
I'm going to ask us to do an exercise that I think might be fun because I kind of want to hear what you're going to say. I want you to think about the time that you rejected a profession, maybe one of these professions that he is describing here for yourself. And I'll start so you get a sense of what I mean. I can remember the moment I decided I didn't want to be a lawyer. Because for a long time, I did want to be a lawyer because, you know, lawyers make good money and they're considered to be very smart people and these sorts of things. And so I signed up for the mock trial team when I was a middle school student. And I was a sixth grader. I was the only sixth grader on the team. And I fully participated up until the time when it came time to go to the actual trial. And it seems like we only did one. Maybe I dropped at the semester mark. So I was not chosen to be one of the, not chosen to be lead counsel. I was just kind of sitting there as an additional person at the table that could kind of, you know, make recommendations or whatnot. And so we went downtown to the courthouse and we and the other team argued this case in front of an actual judge sitting in an actual courtroom, which is really cool. And, I put on a tie and everything. And we were assigned the part of the case that to me was clearly the correct one. It was a criminal case, and it was pretty obvious that the dude was guilty. And we were assigned the prosecution, right? So this is great. I know this case backwards and forwards. We're going to win this thing. Our prosecutors didn't handle the case very well. And I felt like they were asking the wrong questions and they weren't drawing out the right information. And so after we finished and the defense got up and they did a pretty good job, I asked to re-cross-examine the witness. And I asked one question and the witness answered and I sat back down. So at the end, the judge ruled in favor of the other team. And he says, now in this case, the prosecution actually had the right side of the case, but I'm ruling in favor of the defense because they argued it better. This is the only thing that I would say about the prosecution's case was the one question that little guy in the end there asked, that was the right question, right? And I'm sitting there, so I'm upset because we've lost, and I feel like we've lost because I wasn't allowed to run the thing, which is probably not true. But the deeper impact that had on me was I was like, so in law, it doesn't matter who's right. It only matters who can argue best. I don't want anything to do with that. I don't want to be part of a system where innocent men can go to jail or guilty men can go free because the lawyer didn't argue the case right. So that was my Faustian moment of disillusionment with law. Is there something like that in your past?
Yeah, actually there is. And it's funny because you and I have both ended up in our main work as one of the fields he rejects, or actually right. Two. I mean, technically, I think with philosophy and logic, I mean, I teach logic, you're a philosopher and the theologian. But I was raised, we watched a lot of procedural shows growing up, and I very much felt a pull towards law, was on a mock trial team as well in middle school, was on the debate team in college. Most of the people on the debate team ended up in law school or something similar. And even considered at one point applying for a joint JD PhD program, which I'm sure I wouldn't have gotten into, but I thought about it. And I also thought for a while, because when I was first ordained as a priest, I was bivocational and was a teacher. And I thought that it might actually be a little more conducive to my schedule and some other things to potentially become a paralegal. So I actually bought a couple of law books about that would be ways of studying to become a paralegal and things like that, but ended up not doing it. And I think a lot of what you say resonates that, it's not really about truth per se, though I do think there is an important aspect of that, right? Like, especially in terms of defense law, I mean, it is good that the prosecuting team or side has to make a really robust case in order for someone to be convicted of a crime. Because as Plato tells us, it's better for a wicked man to go free than an innocent man to be punished. Mm-hmm. But that is definitely a pause. And then I also thought about it too. And I mean, yes, it's absolutely true that lawyers do provide a service that is valuable. But there is also that kind of reputation that comes along with it about sort of price gouging people, you know, I mean, just charging an exorbitant amount of money. And I know there's a lot of great lawyers who do pro bono work and these kind of things, which are good. But I don't know, that kind of gave me pause, especially when I had the opportunity to become a priest, which I see very much as one of my primary jobs is to help people, you know, walk alongside them, help them bear their burdens, you know, and as a lawyer, there has to be a sort of detachment that I think I was a little uncomfortable with. You know, you lose the case and it's like, all right, well, you know, you still owe me this money. And so, you know, I don't know it, every now and again, you know, something happens and I think, oh man, I should have just been a lawyer instead. But I think generally speaking, I'm very happy to not have been. And there are lawyers at my church who I really love and you know, they're awesome people and they don't fit the stereotypes at all of lawyers. They actually do make the world better through their work. But I don't know.
Well, I had a friend who was going up for the New York bar and she put me down as a character reference. And so I was filling out the form for the character reference for the New York bar. And there was this one question that says, do you know of anything that would disqualify, that would render this candidate morally unacceptable as a lawyer in the state of New York? And I thought to myself, I don't know if I know what you would think would count as rendering someone morally unacceptable for in New York of all places.
That's right.
But listeners, you know, especially for the lawyers out there, remember that I was in middle school. And, you know, I was noticing that the system was susceptible of abuse. But that doesn't mean that one should not get involved in the system. If a lawyer would ask me, so then, you know, I take seriously what you say, how can I keep doing my job? I would point back to that same passage in Augustine's De Doctrina. Why should only injustice, why should only falsehood be armed with those weapons, right?
Yeah, the more good lawyers there are, the better, for sure.
Yeah, exactly right. Exactly.
Absolutely.
Right. So Faustus throws all this stuff away from a shallow reading, and then we learn that when he sat down to have this discussion, he already had something else in mind.
Yep.
Right? It's not as if he's looking at all these things independently and discovering none of them are any good and thinking, well, gosh, now what am I going to do? Here's something I hadn't thought of before. No, he's already been taught. He's been approached by these two other sorcerers who want to draw him in with him, and he's already been considering it. And so really what we have here in this opening scene is a man who is already feeling the temptation and the draw to sorcery, who is looking, casting about for something to hold on to instead, but it's kind of half-hearted because in a way his heart has already been, he's already more than half given in to the temptation to follow the sorcerer's route.
We have to connect something from the last two episodes. We have to see if we can get a streak going where we can quote Aristotle about this. Because at the bottom of the paragraph where he's deciding to become a magician, he says, a sound magician is a mighty god. Here, Faustus, try thy brains to gain a deity. So in other words, these two sorcerers have convinced Faustus that he should become a god, which means they're not his friends.
Yep. Because if they were his friends, they'd wish him to remain as he is. And this is the best argument for what Aristotle's saying that we've seen so far, right?
Yes. Yes. We'll see about next month. We'll see how we can figure out how to integrate that quote with Emma by Jane Austen. But yes.
We'll find a way, listeners. We're committed. I am engaged. Because this is about overreach. This whole thing is about overreach. Yes. That's why the Icarus metaphor is central to what's happening here. He's, you know, a lot of times I teach a lot of books that feature magic in them. And a lot of times I'll have parents or the students themselves come to me and say, I'm a little nervous about this because I'm a Christian and I feel like Christianity is not super friendly towards sorcerers, right? I mean, you've got like, what about like the Witch of Endor? And then there's also like, you know, Simon Magus and all these other magicians in the New Testament who don't come off very well. Isn't it true that sorcery or witchcraft is just that's just devilry, right? It's devil worship and it's other sorts of things. And I always say to them, you've got to pay attention to the context. Like, how is it working in that world? In most of the books that I'm teaching, magic is another form of science. It's a way of manipulating the natural world through means that are naturally available to humans to get certain types of results. Right. And a great example of this is you see this opposition in the Pixar movie Onward, where there's this world where there's magic and these mythological creatures and things. But magic is hard. It takes a lot of study and training and practice, and only certain people can do it. And you got to have staff, whereas technology is easy. So you can study for 5 years to be able to make a little tiny light out of your hand, or you can flip a switch and anyone can do that and turn light on. And so the society turns from magic to technology. That's not what's happening here. This type of sorcery magic is the type of sorcery and magic that those people are actually concerned about, where the thing is you're gaining access to powers that humans are not meant to have access to. And the only way you can gain that access, see, Faustus doesn't actually do any magic. Faustus just has Mephistopheles do the magical things for him. And so what it means to be a sorcerer is to be somebody who has submitted yourself to not only a lord other than the lord, but in fact a demonic lord and the enemy of mankind, because by doing so you can get them to obey your wishes for a time.
And I think it's helpful to maybe draw out a sort of medieval tendency, and I think that maybe Marlowe is playing with this a little bit too, that like what Faust articulates there at the end, this idea of to become a god, and it's very similar to the temptation of Adam and Eve. You'll be like God, you know. Mm-hmm. A lot of the medieval theologians said, well, that's not really the problem, that they wanted to be like God. In fact, to want to be like God is actually a good thing.
Yeah, you were made to be like God.
Exactly. It's the means that they employ to be like God that are right. unfitting is right. is the big term that they use. So you want, maybe you want the thing, but you want it in an immeasured way or in an immeasured magnitude, or you take steps to get to that thing that are not the right steps. So here Faustus is sort of circumventing the normal ways in which one can become like God, the sacraments, you know, the holy life, prayer, these kind of things. No, that takes a lot of work. He wants it right now. It's an unfitting desire.
Yeah.
And so, you know, that's why I think it's helpful. I think Augustine would kind of agree with this too. It's sort of an Augustinian tendency to say, well, there's nothing that's like pure evil. Mm-hmm. There's always some good wrapped up in our evil. And that's what makes it kind of nuanced. I mean, it's easy to see with Faustus here because he's literally making a pact with Satan. But for most of us, when we make those Faustian bargains, there's something good.
Yeah.
That we're acting towards or trying to act towards. The man in the brothel is looking for God.
Yeah, that's right.
But he's just looking in the wrong place. It gets twisted.
Yeah, looking for love in all the wrong places.
That's right.
It reminds me very much of in The Dark Tower, C.S. Lewis, The Dark Tower, which was the abandoned sequel to Out of the Silent Planet. Hmm. The men are talking, and this guy is interested in this experience of as a scientist. He's interested in the experience of a chronoscope, you're creating something that is able to view other times. And he's working from some accounts that were in the popular papers of Lewis's day that Lewis himself believed, at least at one point in his life, of these individuals who claimed to have memories of other time periods when they could not possibly have lived. And it wasn't presented as if this person was a reincarnation of that person, but rather that they were having a sort of mystical experience where they were snatched out of their time into another time and were able to view things that were happening there and describe them with accuracy. And so he's thinking, the scientist character is thinking about ways to get at this. And he says he even considered Christian mysticism, that maybe that might be a path to having this type of experience. And he ultimately decided against it because in his preliminary researches into it, it was going to be too arduous and difficult a thing to get to. And at this point, the character Ransom laughs, and everyone's like, what do you find so funny? And he's like, the idea that you could accidentally become a saint along the way to doing something else. He's like, don't you get that? By the time you had achieved the means you're looking for, you would have had to have become so interested in something else or better someone else that you would have given up your other search along the way. And no one can kind of respond to this. It's kind of this awkward pause. And the guy continues like, well, anyway, so the next thing I did was, right. And so there's this, I think it's a really good way of underscoring what's wrong with these approaches you're talking about, the approach that of trying to be like God sinfully,
right,
is there's a contradiction built into the idea of trying to be like God apart from God.
Yeah.
Right. That's not going to work. It feels to us like that's a very reasonable thing. Why not? Sure, I can do that. But that's because you don't really understand what the type of thing that God is and what being like God would entail.
That's right. Well, and you end up settling for, I think what you see in Faust is he's settling for finiteness. I mean, even he's going to be a God, but there's a contract, and in the contract that's has right. an end date.
That's right.
Whereas, you know, in the Christian tradition, I mean, Lewis plays on this, and I think you find it in like Gregory Nyssa, you know, the further up, further in. Mm-hmm. There, it's the never ending mystery into which we are always playing into. So it's very different.
Yeah.
And it's amazing to me that he can't see that.
Yeah. Yeah. Well,
chooses not to, perhaps.
That's the blindness of pleasure.
Right.
Right. In the moment, I mean, you could think about this in very harmless, quote unquote, ways. Just, you know, you shouldn't have another piece of cake. You know for a fact that if you don't stop eating so much, you're going to continue getting fatter. And yet, here's the piece of cake right in front of you. And it's your favorite kind of cake. And it's so moist. It's so good. And so you just eat it, even though you know it's against the best advice of doctors and all these other sorts of things. We choose the pleasure of the cake in the moment, even though in a deeper sense, we spend so much time worrying about how we look and what the case is going to do to our health and these other sorts of things, we choose to shorten our lives for more bacon. Because in the moment of smelling bacon, it takes saintly restraint not to eat some bacon, right?
I often have that experience, like, you know, you're at a party and there's alcohol, and like, you know, I'm not a prude about that. I like to drink, but you know, there's drinking to excess, and it's like I always feel terrible when I do that.
Yeah.
But then I do it sometimes, and I'm like, why did I do that? Or then I'll go to the party, you know, the next time, and I won't have much. You know, I'll drink water and just kind of hang out, and it's like, oh, I really enjoyed that a lot more than normal.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah, for that, you know, depending on your metabolism, for the space of anywhere from say 30 minutes to 90 minutes of a pretty good feeling, you're gonna buy that at the cost of several hours of misery, right? Yep. For me, it starts in the middle of the night. I can't sleep well and whatnot, and then there's the misery the next morning as well that can last a good portion of the day. We are characteristically given to be incapable of seeing anything beyond the joys that are immediately pressed in front of us because we live our lives urgently, right? And what is the great mark of urgency? You don't slow down. Urgency causes you to hurry. We feel urgent because we feel our mortality. We know we don't have that long in this life. And so we're trying to fit it all in, and we're trying to just like cram as much joy and pleasure and everything into this life as we can. We write bucket lists, things that we don't want to have died without doing. The point of if Faust had read deeper in theology, he would have seen that one of the greatest promise of Christianity is life everlasting.
Right.
What the resurrection means is that the finish line for when you've got to get it all done by is pushed out from 4 score and 10 all the way to the end of all things. It's pushed into eternity. There is no end date, right? I don't do bucket lists because whatever I don't get done on this side of death, I'll do on the other side.
That's right.
And it'll be better. I'm going to have to redo everything that I do on this side of death anyway, because it'll be better over there. But at the same time, today, this very day, I have chosen and will choose to not focus on that and to do things that are contrary to what will bring me more in tune with that eternity, because they're right here and they smell so good. They look so nice, or whatever the thing is that draws me in. Right. And that's what I meant earlier about that. We are all Faust. This is probably the most important morality play of all.
Yeah.
Right. Because this is, every single day we call upon Mephistopheles rather than calling upon the name of the Lord.
And I think Kristen Rudd and I had a conversation last week that came out on the podcast feed about monsters and literature. But I think the concept of witchcraft came up there, and it's come up here again. And I do think it's interesting, you know, that it's the highest good, the highest end that brings significance to the present. So in a Christian perspective, you know, we have this end, which is to be with God forever, the beatific vision, and what we do, that end makes what we do right now significant. So there, it brings a sense of urgency to the present, right? I've got to work through some of this stuff so I can get there. When you don't have that higher end, and of course we have a uniquely Christian one, and we have a diverse group of listeners who may conceive of the higher ends differently than we do, but I think there's still sort of an end that they're looking towards in for many. But once you dismiss that higher end, then you do end up seeing things as manipulable, right? In the present, because it's about whatever it is that you decide that it's about, just like Faustus is doing, right? He wants to become a god, and so he's going to do whatever it means to get there, and his end becomes a sort of earthly pleasure. So much so that he's willing to sell his soul. But I do think it's interesting that in a culture where we have begun to get rid of the idea of the highest end, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, this is the project of existentialism, right? You don't have an essence, your existence precedes your essence. You make what you want out of life.
Yeah.
It's all absurd. And so it's whatever you want it to be, that you do see an increase in witchcraft,
mm-hmm.
Right? You go to Barnes and Noble and the spirituality section is all about witchcraft. And there's it's like a weird kind of positive thinking culture kind of mixes with it. It's a very interesting and kind of nihilistic worldview, because there's no end.
Yeah.
And so this is Faustus becomes unmoored and nothing makes sense. I mean, he can't, even when he's confronted with the opportunity to change, he can't.
Yeah. Yeah. So good. So you reminded me of a line in Act 1, Scene 4 in my version. He's talking about, you know, Mephistopheles shows up and Faustus is like, I conjured Mephistopheles. And Mephistopheles is like, I mean, you conjured and I came. But the reason was not because you conjured, or rather that was only an accidental reason. He says per accidents, but really we show up when we hear anybody blaspheme God, like, and they're in danger of losing their soul. That's when we show up. So yeah, you caused me to come, but not because you're a great conjurer, because you're an idiot. And so he says, you know, what you've got to do is, you know, abjure the Trinity and pray devoutly to the Prince of Hell. And Faustus says, I've already done this. A couple lines into that, he says, this word damnation terrifies not me, for I confound hell in Elysium. Okay, I mean, what do you think you're saying, Faust? Because you're right, that's exactly what you're doing. You're confusing heaven and hell, and therefore you're not afraid of damnation because you think it's salvation. But you're admitting that you're wrong. And then he calls these questions about the souls of men, he calls them vain trifles. It's a vain trifle to talk about the souls of men. Again, that's a very contemporary sounding thing. People don't want to talk about religion and spirituality. That's not important stuff. Important stuff is like politics and economics and whatnot. And then further on in this dialogue, this scene really jumped out to me. I had not noticed this before. Mephistopheles, pre-Milton's Milton.
Yes.
Right? He says, Faust says, because Mephistopheles says he's damned with Lucifer, unhappy, in hell. And Faust says, then how comes it that thou art out of hell? And Mephistopheles says, why, this is hell.
Right.
Nor am I out of it. Thinkest thou that I that saw the face of God and tasted, that's a lovely image of Echo of Gabriel there, by the way, at the Annunciation of the birth of John the Baptist. I that saw the face of God and tasted the eternal joys of heaven am not tormented with 10,000 hells in being deprived of everlasting bliss. Well, that's not, I began to wonder if Mephistopheles knows what he's about, right? I mean, like, that's not the thing you want to say to the guy who's trying to make the same decision you made.
Yeah.
But once again, you can't, I mean, he can say it because he knows it won't matter. He knows Faust's heart is already given over to this. And I think he enjoys the fact that he's going to be able to say to him, he says at the very end of the play, you know, Faust's like, you, this is your fault. And Mephistopheles is like 100% guilty. Right. And I loved doing it, right?
Yep.
Had a great time doing it. Thank you so much for playing this game.
It is, it's pretty unreal that Faust is surprised that a demon is acting like a demon.
That's right. That's right. I thought you were my friend. Did you really? How dumb are you?
Yeah, it makes for the time when Faust is in control of Mephistopheles feels like a really weird buddy comedy, but it's only one direction. Like,
yeah,
you know, Faust thinks he's his buddy, but Mephistopheles the whole time knows.
Yeah.
It's a temporary investment for an eternal gain.
That's right. And the 25 years for Mephistopheles is, I mean, it's such a brief time. It's like a few seconds, if even that, because he's going to suffer forever. And it gets, you know, he gets some, it's fun. He gets a diversion out of it. Doesn't lessen his suffering any, we see here, 10,000 hells every moment from being deprived of the face of God. But nevertheless, it's something to do.
Yeah, right. Right.
And we've seen that too, right? Wretched people. I was this way when I was a child. Oh, I was the worst. I was wretched and unhappy. And one of the few things that made me feel better was making other people wretched and unhappy.
Misery loves
company. Oh my gosh, it's used to scrub, isn't it?
That's right.
You always think you're going to be Lucy or Peter or even Edmund in the Chronicles of Narnia, but most of us are just Eustace.
That's right. That's right. Yes.
There's a lot of my underlining throughout this play are things like that, where it's so clear what's going on. There's another thread of these though that you see this come out with the Faust says it a few times, the old man says it at the end, this notion that and I may be revealing my version of the text here, this notion that if you would only repent, God would forgive you. And that even for the demons, even for the devils, if they would only repent, God would forgive you. And the old man says, you may have sinned like a devil, but don't persevere like a devil, right?
Yep.
Turn away even now. And Faust comes close a couple times and the demons show up and they get mean and they threaten him, right? And then at the end, he laments, oh, I can't. But it's like, you haven't tried.
Right.
And this is, you know, again, get echoes of Hamlet there with Claudius and his attempt at repentance, but he can't repent because his heart's not in it, because he doesn't want to give up the things that he did the sin for.
That's right. Yeah. Well, it made me think of Dante when I was reading those parts. You know, all you have to do is repent. I mean, you get to Purgatorio and there are the souls there who at the last minute, they repented.
One of them is just the word Mary. That's enough. Not even Jesus, just Mary.
Yeah. Yeah. The bar is really low. Is the point. It's really not hard. It's supposed to be low on purpose, you know. It's like baptism. It's like it's intentionally hard to mess up baptizing someone. It's the easiest one. A non-Christian can even do it, you know. It's supposed to be easy.
Yeah.
And so yeah, so you get to your Purgatorio and it's like, yeah, all these souls they converted at the last second. And so it's always available to Faust, but yes, and that ossification, I think, that occurs in him through the pleasure, right? So, when they have to sort of re-ratify the contract and his blood coagulates, and you get that feeling at that moment that he's having a tough time with it.
Yeah.
Isn't it right after that, that he gets, Helen?
Yeah. That's right. Yeah, there's a couple of times, you know, they bring the parade of the vices in to distract him. And then he, you know, they bring Helen in. Well, he asked for Helen. But there's the demons are, every time they're about to lose their grip on him to repentance, they bring in something to distract him. And that's their language, right? To distract and delight. And so the whole point of delight and pleasure in the demon's minds is that it keeps you from thinking about the things that are really important until it's too late to do anything about it.
Yes. Yes.
By the way, another great connection you just made there with it's the first time he's making the contract and his blood coagulates before he can finish writing out everything he wants to write, because he does go on, right? I feel like if I'm writing with my blood, I would be terse, but he isn't. And so he asked this, you know, why did my blood coagulate? Like, what does this mean? And it kind of reminds me of that bit when in Macbeth, when he comes in and he's not able to say amen.
Yeah.
And he's like, but wherefore could I not say amen? Like, what does it mean that I couldn't say amen? Is my soul in danger? Same question.
Yeah, absolutely. And I do love it too. So I think it actually, and again, this might be an ordering thing in mine.
It could be, yeah.
So his blood congeals, he can't go on, the deed eventually gets done because they burn the blood, which I think is also significant, and he gets that inscription on his arm, right? And then the first thing he wants is a wife.
Yes,
because again, there's some goodness there.
Yeah.
And that's like the last thing that the demons want him to have.
Yeah,
like, do anything but a wife. Don't get married.
And he's like, I have to have a wife, because like I'm not gonna be able to control my lust, so I need to have a place to put that. And that is the way that the Catholic Church talks about the sacrament of marriage. It's a remedy against lust, right?
Yeah.
You give a proper balance for it. And Mephistopheles is like, don't mention marriage to me again.
Yeah.
It's stupid. Okay, I can bring you all the prettiest women in the world, and you can have sex with them, and that's fine. We'll do it that way. And Faust is like, oh yeah, that does sound pretty good, actually.
I did find it interesting too. That it's shortly after that you get the parade of the seven deadly sins.
Mm.
And Faustus does not like them.
He does not.
He says they're ugly and he wants them to go back to hell.
And he, along, which I thought he would especially be drawn to, because he said that about himself and the whole Helen thing, but he's just like, nope, get him out. And then once they're gone, he's like, that was fun.
It's very strange. Yes. And I think that's part of it too, is that one of the foundational virtues for Christian living is that idea of stability. And you see it in Boethius. I think, you know, it doesn't really matter what happens out there. What matters is what you do in here. Mm-hmm. That's all you can control. And yeah. So stability is a mark of a person who is in control. And Faust, in his sort of back and forth all the time, he wants to repent, but then he doesn't. He mm-hmm. wants a wife, but then he doesn't. The seven deadly sins need to go back to hell, but actually it was kind of fun. He's showing himself to be this wavering man. He's blown and tossed by the wind. That's the lack of stability, which is exactly, it's like in Inferno. That's one of the punishments of the lust is that they're blown about by the wind because they can't control their own passions. And so Faust is very much in that same boat.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Well, as we think about putting this to bed, then, I mean, reflecting on all of this in light of what we've been saying here, I mean, what's so great about this text pedagogically is it's a great example of what the medievals would have called a negative exemplum, right? Yep. You teach people virtue by showing them the consequences of vice. But because it's done in the Renaissance, it's done differently than it would have been done in the Middle Ages. There's a lot more subtle psychology to it. There's an attention to the psychology of the self-destructing soul. And you can just sort of, you can really dissect him and notice all these things that are going on that are, you know, it's your soul and your tiny choices blown up big to make it easier to see what's really at stake in taking that other piece of cake or whatever the thing is that's tempting you these days. And so it is really a remarkable thing, and it deserves to be read. I mean, honestly, if next time I'm doing a reading list, I'm going to put one less Shakespeare play on to make space for this. You know, we can read one less Shakespeare and spend some time on Marlowe.
Can I read one section as we kind of come to an end and just say one more thing about it? Because I think,
please.
I've been toying around with this idea. And I don't know, I guess in Catholicism, there's personalism, right? The significance of the person. And I've been sort of toying with the idea of like a new Christian humanism or something, you know, that I think our faith as Christians needs to make us more human.
Mm-hmm.
It's really important that we understand that aspect. And that's why some culturally Christian things I have a problem with, because I actually think they make us less human, like the way Christians have engaged politically and these kind of things have not always been very good for us. Sin, though, is the ultimate dehumanizing thing, right? It's making us inhuman rather than humanizing. Yeah. And in Act 5, Scene 2, at least in my version, Faust is with the scholars, the young scholars, and he knows his end is coming and he's lamenting to them. And one of the scholars says, "Faustus, look up to heaven. Remember God's mercies are infinite." Faust says, "But Faustus's offenses can ne'er be pardoned. The serpent that tempted Eve may be saved, but not Faustus."
Mm-hmm.
He's too far gone. And then the third scholar says, "Yet Faustus, call on God." And Faustus says, "On God whom Faustus hath abjured, on God whom Faustus hath blasphemed, ah, my God, I would weep. But the devil draws in my tears, gush forth blood instead of tears, yea, life and soul. Oh, he stays my tongue. I would lift up my hands, but see, they hold them. They hold them." But I think that idea of tears, you know, it's interesting. If you read the church fathers, like the desert fathers, they really emphasize tears and repentance and contrition.
Yeah.
Pierced by Love. But Dr. Hans Borsma just wrote a book, Pierced by Love, and he has a whole section about the necessity of tears and repentance. It's all over the medievals. And where Faust is at the end of the book, after making this deal with the devil, after then living this life that's based on sort of a hedonistic pleasure seeking and really domination is where he's at, is that he's lost his humanity to the point that he can't even cry.
Yeah.
He can't even. And in fact, this was, I think, a common view at the time that witches couldn't weep. They were incapable of it because they've severed part of their humanity.
Yeah.
And so this, I think, becomes the point. You know, oftentimes Christians and morality plays in general, I think, can be read as kind of legalistic. Mm-hmm. And it's certainly true that, at least with Christians, I don't know about morality plays, but Christians can be legalistic.
Mm-hmm.
The point, though, is that sin, vice, makes us less human.
Yeah.
And Faust is a good example of someone who loses that humanity. And it's tragic when that happens. It's there's nothing sadder than ruining something that's so beautiful and so good as a human being.
Yeah. That's great. That's a great way to tie it together.
So I suppose we should do end notes. We made the mistake. We usually record in the evening. And I feel like by the time we're done recording, it's getting dark outside and I'm kind of feels like we're coming to an end, but we are recording this in the afternoon and it's still bright outside. And I feel like I could keep going for another hour, but we'll spare our listeners.
That's right. That's listener abuse.
Geneva Convention violation of cruel and unusual punishment. But let's talk about end notes. What do you have for your end note? I'm excited about yours.
Okay. So I'm silly. My end note is the mid-2000s remake of Bedazzled with Elizabeth Hurley playing the devil and Brendan Fraser playing the role of the character who makes the Faustian bargain. It doesn't take itself too seriously at all. It's hilarious. But it also is, it's the story, right? I mean, it's very much this sense of the devil writes you a contract promising you everything you want. And he goes for it. And then you see how the devil is intentionally twisting the things he's asking for, not even wanting to make him happy in getting the happiness as the intermediate happiness for the sake of which he's going to lose his soul. And so it's quite nice. There is at the end of it, spoiler, there's a path made open to salvation that we don't find in this Faustus. We do find it in Goethe's Faust. And so there's some disagreement in the tradition. Some people really wanted to see Faust saved for different reasons, but it's a good way to inhabit. I think it's a good way to inhabit some of the space, and also a good presentation of some of the dynamics of demonic temptation and Faustian bargains.
I love it. I have three. I'm going to go with all three.
All right.
Normally I find end notes to be kind of hard actually, but this one, I maybe it's because the book was so short and I finished it. I had more time to sort of ruminate than I often do, which is my own fault, mea culpa. So the first is a rock opera, Beethoven's Last Night by the Trans-Siberian Orchestra. And the rock opera takes place as Beethoven's getting ready to die and Mephistopheles comes and they work on making a bargain. But it ends very differently than Faust does. But a lot of the things that we're talking about come into play in the rock opera. And so I don't know. It's a pretty cool, the music's okay. I mean, it's not like the best musical album ever, but it's good. So that's an interesting thing to put in conversation with Dr. Faustus. The second thing, so we have started having time for people to come make their confession at the church. And so during the downtime when I'm in the confessional, because I don't bring my phone or my Apple Watch, because, you know, if you bring your Apple Watch or your phone and your FBI agent knows your sins, that's fine. But my FBI agent shouldn't know your sins is my theory. But anyway, so I bring a book or two, usually devotional, you know, and I bring a prayer book and I try and pray, but sometimes I read. And so I was reading Hugh of St. Victor's Dialogue between Reason and the Soul. And it sort of is the anti-Faust. So the soul and reason are talking, and the soul takes reason up to see, or reason takes the soul up to see the whole world. And it kind of zooms in on different vignettes. Oh, look at these merchants who are traveling. What do you think about that? And and the soul says, oh, that seems really good. You know, that they're traveling and they're making wealth. And then all of a sudden soldiers come and attack the caravan and take all the things. And so reason asks, well, what do you think now? And he goes, well, it seems like a waste to base your life on that. And he goes through every sort of money, power, sex, you know, everything. And at the end, after the soul sees it all play out, while initially it seems good, he says, yeah, but that can't be it.
Yeah.
And it's sort of Boethian in its conclusion, which is that the soul can only really rest in God. That's the ultimate end, and all these other things are fleeting and they go away. That the you know, while they're maybe gifts from God that we can use to learn, they're not ultimate because they pass away. And so if Faust maybe had Hugh of St. Victor's dialogue between reason and the soul, maybe he wouldn't have made the decision that he made. Mm. I don't know.
Nice.
So that was my second. The third, and this comes up a couple times throughout the book, and I think like that line of Faust, well, the devil that tempted Eve might be saved before I would be saved.
Yeah.
I would really recommend, as we think about these topics of sort of last things and ultimate ends and things, von Balthasar's Dare We Hope That All Be Saved. Mm-hmm. I think he does a really good job of taking some of the passages in scripture about judgment and saying, hey, there's an inward turn here. Like, this is about you right mm-hmm. now. And so when we read a book like Dr. Faustus, sometimes it can be easy to look down on him as a character or even to put other people in his place.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so-and-so did this like a Faustian bargain, you know?
Yeah.
And certainly we can learn from those examples, but when we put ourselves up as judge, sometimes we miss the fact that we're in the same position all the time. And yeah. I think von Balthasar really challenges us to, before we do any of that, it's about us. It's about me. Like Kierkegaard says, I'm sure all of you will be saved. It's me I'm worried about. And I think that's a good posture to go into a book like this with. So those are my three recommendations, overdoing it. But
nice. Anyways. Well, we should do that from Balthasar together someday.
Oh, that would be fun. That would be a lot of fun. I do love it. I think he's awesome. And I know you wrote your dissertation about von Balthasar.
I did. Yep.
Yeah. So I'm not worthy. Well, anyways, well, listeners, thank you so much for joining us in this discussion. We will be back next month with Emma by Jane Austen. That'll be a little bit of a change. It's still British, but of a later date and a different form, the novel. So I'm very much looking forward to that. And in the meantime, keep reading.